The diplomatic row between Canada and India worsens as Ottawa expels six Indian diplomats after linking them to a killing of a Sikh separatist leader. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police earlier said the government of India had undertaken a broad campaign against Indian dissidents and used organized crime to target the South Asian community in Canada. Canada says the government had requested India remove the diplomatic immunity of the six so they could be questioned regarding allegations of criminal activity. But since India did not cooperate, it had to expel the diplomats.
I know the events of the past year and today's revelations have shaken many Canadians, particularly those in the Indo-Canadian and Sikh community. Many of you are angry, upset, frightened. I get that. This shouldn't happen. Canada and India have a long and storied history rooted in people-to-people ties, business, and trade. But we cannot abide by what we're seeing right now. We will never tolerate the involvement of a foreign government threatening and killing Canadian citizens on Canadian soil. A deeply unacceptable violation of Canada's sovereignty and of international law.
New Delhi has retaliated by also ordering the expulsion of six high-ranking Canadian diplomats. It also says it withdrew its envoy from Canada, contradicting Ottawa's statement of expulsion. Ties have been frayed since Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said last year he had evidence linking Indian agents to the assassination of a Sikh leader on Canadian territory. Former U.S. President Bill Clinton campaigns for Democratic presidential candidate Kamala Harris in the battleground state of Georgia. Harris and Republican rival Donald Trump are locked in a tight race ahead of the November 5 election, which is expected to be decided by slim margins. In 2021, Democrats completed a sweep of the two U.S. Senate seats up for grabs in Georgia, as President Joe Biden won the state by a slim margin. Clinton telling supporters they can win the state again.
So that's what this election coming down to. If you want it bad enough, you can win it.
Yeah.
And you'll be proud of yourself for the rest of your life. But don't forget, they'll be better off if you win. And you won't be better off if they win. So for the sake of the children and those of you who have grandchildren, including me, please make sure we turn out. All we got to do is show up. If we show up, we'll win.
That's right.
And it's in your hands.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning, our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. We begin on the campaign trail of the U.S. presidential race. When it comes to his supporters, Donald Trump will make sure that America will be great again through stricter immigration policies.
Border security was the focus of Donald Trump's Sunday rally in Prescott Valley, Arizona, pledging to hire 10,000 additional Border Patrol agents if reelected.
But after I win, I will be asking Congress immediately to approve a 10% raise. I haven't had one in a long time for all agents. And a $10,000 each retention and signing bonus. So we're going to retain them.
Trump is locked in a tight race with Vice President Kamala Harris ahead of the November 5 elections, but the former president is seen by many voters as the best candidate to tackle illegal immigration, which remains a top voter issue.
If Kamala gets four more years, the entire country will be turned into a migrant camp, and that's what's happening. Millions and millions of people. When I win on November 5th, the migrant invasion ends and the restoration of our country begins.
Immigration and border security were also major highlights in Trump's speech to supporters in Coachella, California on Saturday. But what happened on the sidelines made even more headlines, as a man identified as 49-year-old Vem Miller was arrested at a security checkpoint near Trump's rally and now faces gun charges after he was found in possession of loaded firearms, multiple passports, and a fake license plate.
If you're asking me right now,
I probably did have deputies that prevented the third assassination attempt.
Meanwhile, Trump has also sought to portray the Biden-Harris administration's response to recent storms as ineffective, including claiming without evidence that aid and federal emergency management agency funds had been diverted to migrants.
In response to Trump's claims, Vice President Kamala Harris reiterated the administration's efforts to support the people affected by Hurricane Milton.
Our administration has mobilized thousands of federal personnel across the region to work hand in hand with local and state officials to give folks the help they need. I have spoken with state, local officials, both Republican and Democrat, to let them know we will be with you every step of the way as you recover and rebuild.
President Joe Biden has already approved a disaster declaration to free up federal funds to victims of Milton and provide them grants for temporary housing, home repairs, and loans. On the day Biden signed the declaration, more than 250,000 Floridians already registered to get help. The additional $612 million to support people affected by recent hurricanes also includes money for utility companies to improve their power systems.
And finally, Pinoy pride in local government. New York City Mayor Eric Adams has promoted Phil M. Maria Torres Springer to first deputy mayor.
Filipino-American Deputy Mayor Maria Torres Springer is taking on a new critical role in New York City as first deputy mayor. NYC Mayor Eric Adams has announced the promotion of Deputy Mayor for Housing, Economic Development, and Workforce, Torres Springer, to the position of First Deputy Mayor, assuming oversight of the First Deputy Mayor portfolio and provide strategic direction and operational and budgetary oversight for the City of New York. She is expected to continue her work in housing and economic development, given its significance to the administration's agenda. Torres Springer is credited for leading ambitious and record-breaking efforts to accelerate New York City's recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, making strides on issues like housing and affordability. In a 2023 flag-raising Philippine Independence Day event in New York City, Torres Springer underscored the importance of representation in local government.
The fact that you see Filipino-Americans in elected office, in agency leadership, in leadership across different sectors, means that we're making progress as a people.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.
At least 21 are killed and 4 injured in an airstrike in northern Lebanon as Israel expands its targets in its war with Hezbollah militants. The mayor of the Christian-majority town of Aitu says the airstrike hit a house that had been rented to displaced families. So far, the main focus of Israeli's military operations in Lebanon has been on the south. Visiting a military base where 4 soldiers were killed by Hezbollah drones Sunday, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Israel would continue to attack the Iran-backed movement without mercy everywhere in Lebanon. 3 U.S.-based academics win this year's Nobel Prize for Economics. Darren Acemoglu, Simon Johnson, and James Robinson were recognized for their work on how institutions are formed and affect a nation's prosperity. The Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences says their research showed how societal institutions can help reduce the vast income disparities between countries, which it says is one of the greatest challenges today.
If you look at support for democracy in the industrialized world, it's at an all-time low. People are much more willing to say they would be okay or they would support an authoritarian regime or dictatorship, military rule or rule by a junta. And if you dig deeper, it is at least in part rooted in their disappointment with democracy. Democracy hasn't realized its promise of voice for all and shared prosperity for all.
You know, we've had a bumpy ride on democracy, and what happens next in the November election is extremely consequential for whether we can sustain our better, stronger institutions and have more shared prosperity going forward.
The 3 economists will share the 11 million Swedish crowns or $1 million cash reward from the Swedish Central Bank.